So let me tell you what's going on. It's called life. Life in South Florida, and I've lost connection. I did, at least temporarily, with the studio, but we are going to proceed just the same. I wanted to let you know that today, of course, the big news is that there is something of an arrangement, some kind of an agreement between the president and Congress on funding for his famous wall. Frankly, at this point, we'll see. The attitude we should have is we'll just see what is worked out, but we shouldn't get all excited about it. You know how these things work. The news is manufactured, and the news today is this is what we ought to be paying attention to. You know, we should all be paying attention to this, and this should occupy our minds for the entire day and beyond. I say no. Life goes on, and what we try to do is to put some perspective in our lives. And don't get all excited about it because they still don't know what they're doing. They're trying to figure out something because they have to present something to the public as evidence that they have worked on this matter and that they have reached a conclusion. Well, you know, okay. So our attitude should be, we shall see what you came up with. We shall see. But until then, we're not getting all excited about it. Okay, so that's that. I just want to ask the studio if you could confirm for me whether you're receiving any of my materials. Bad news. So what I have to do right now is to switch up dramatically my planned program for today. And it was to really discuss, you know, it's Black History Month. We've gotten a bit off track. And in my view, we thought we would continue, you know, to just keep the vibe going. But it's not working. So we will just talk to each other for the hour about issues that are occurring in our country and outside of it that you think are important. And we will find out what it is that's on your mind today. 888-874-4888 is the number to call. We'll talk. We'll talk instead. You know, I want to come back to this theme that we started out with. I was going to talk with you about something else. We'll do that tomorrow. There's no problem. But sometimes things happen. And on my end here in South Florida, when I'm connected to the studio, most of the time, everything works just fine. But at times like this. And I sent my program in since last night. So we should have had some kind of, it should have gone nicely, but it didn't. But there's no need to get all flustered about it. We just keep moving. Keep moving. This debacle that we find ourselves in, we should put it in perspective. We should understand, and this is how we should function. We have nothing to do with this. We have nothing to do with the feverish attempts to persuade us that a group of people in Washington, the president, members of Congress, are trying to hammer out an agreement over the building of a wall and other funds to keep the government going. Now, we know at the base of it is the day-to-day life and benefit of 800,000 workers that essentially were kept as hostages to this whole process. That's my view. This was so irregular, so wrong in so many ways, that Donald Trump decided to stick up the country and to hold as hostages 800,000 people who had their jobs and were able with their paychecks to take care of their families and their responsibilities and so forth. And he just arbitrarily decided, since it looks like he was going to get some trouble from Congress, we'll just go with Plan B, his sudden Plan B. And Plan B involved just sticking up the country and extorting or attempting to extort money so that he could build this wall as a major political achievement coming into the political season of 2020. This would have been an extraordinary achievement for him to begin that process and to use it as an anchor for his political accomplishments. Well, the point I'm raising, because people were raising other points, they're raising the point about how much money would it take and how long would it take and do you need a wall and all these things to me were secondary to the central question. Did the president commit an illegal act by taking as hostages 800,000 workers, putting them, in a situation they never anticipated? They had their jobs, they were working at their jobs, they did not commit any disciplinary infraction of any sort, anything that would cause them to even have to consider what is going to become of them. The stress alone must have been awful. The president, in my view, and the actions of the president to begin with, should be the focus. And the focus should be that because, at least in our minds, at least we're told and we're asked to believe that this is a democratic government. This is a democracy. And we're not supposed to have a renegade or rogue president doing whatever he wishes, and who clearly believes that as president, he has access to the till at any time he wants. He just needs to stick his hand into the till and take out what he wants to do what he wants. This is, to me, the central question. It's not about whether, they get this matter solved and how they're going to fix it. It is first tackling the issue that the president is out of order. He is violating constitutional law by deciding that he does not need any input from Congress at all. He does not need to consult with anybody. He can just go ahead and do what he wants to do in whatever fashion he wishes to do it. That is, to me, the big question. Do we have a democratic process here? Do we have a president who is accountable to the people, or do we have a whole other thing? Do we have a dictator, and do we have a fascist, and do we have somebody who decides that the people's money is his money, and this country is his personal property? That's the issue for me. So I'm not excited, and I'm not worrying about, my gosh, what will happen? Will they agree? How will this all turn out? I don't care about that. I care that the central issue continues to be ignored and set aside, because it informs, this president's attitude informs all these other things. And at least from the point of view of Congress, the representatives of the people, we should get an indication that they're conscious of this. That's the very basis for their existence, that they are there to represent the interests of the people. They are given power and authority to be a check and balance against potential, let alone actual, craziness of a president who intends to listen to no one, who attempts to just run the country however he sees fit, and who, above all, believes himself to be totally unaccountable. Not only does he function like that, the attitude has been implanted in his cabinet, his sons, his daughter, who are senior advisors. They're all operating on the same idea. They have no reason to account to anybody. And we do not know what the heck is going on. This particular project is $5.7 billion. This is the magic number that they're waving in front of us. But we know that even that is a lie, because the wall itself may cost that in estimation, but you have all these other ancillary costs that will push that $5.7 billion way above the mark. You're talking about administrative processes and personnel. You're talking about people who have to now guard this new wall. Where are they going to come from? Where is the money going to come from to pay them? You're talking about courts that now have to be constructed and for the processing of refugees. You're talking about the resolution of cases, thousands and thousands of cases that have gone nowhere. You're talking about the resolution of children snatched by this government. This government is acting like a total criminal. Snatched from their parents, they have not been reunited. Nobody knows where they are. Nobody knows how to reunite them. That is a process that has to be funded. So when you talk about this $5.7 billion, understand that that is the typical way that a lying, deceitful government that should have no credibility with us at all from just the sheer volume of lies, when it says, A, we should absolutely, automatically reject it and treat it as, well, that's just what they say. We have no idea whether it's the truth. But let's get on to our program today. We're staying the course. We're doing our job. And we will see what they come up with. And I'm just waiting for the American people to be resolute about this one thing. This country has gone to hell under this president in terms of all the democratic pillars that we assume are still in place. They're not. And time and again, it is the ordinary people, the regular people, working people, working poor people, and even well-to-do people who have an appreciation for how this country ought to be run. That is what we ought to be concerned about. So 888-874-4888. Daryl from New York, we'll start with you. You're on the air.
Patrice, it's so good to talk to you in snowy New York.
Thank you. How are you doing?
Let's just say the weather is marvelous, and I'm having a lot of fun. With regard to what you were just discussing, well, starting from where you first began at Black History Month, I really appreciate the information that you brought to us about Haiti, and Kim Ive brought to us about Haiti, and that and Venezuela would be really interesting if the news media would focus on that rather than what they're talking about, because that is something that it just boggles that you pick a gentleman, you train him, you send him into a country. I'm not clear how the national, well, let me not get into that. All right, so first addressing what you were talking about, 270 votes in the House of Representatives and 67 votes in the Senate, and there need be nothing to be spoken of. There need be no shutdown. You have a clean bill And if everyone in the United States who gave money and sent the federal workers to the food banks, and just as an aside, there were several demonstrations inside the halls of Congress by one of the by the American Federation of Government Employees during the last situation. However, rather than going to the food bank, or to Jose, that wonderful chef who set up all those workers need to go to the White House and ask for the loan that they were talking about, or the Secretary of was it Commerce or Treasury who said they should go to the banks and get loans?
Commerce.
Right. I mean, like, no touch, right? So why don't we put some of this is on the workers. Most of it is on Mitch McConnell and the Congress. This $1.3 billion they're talking about is $2.2 billion less than $1.5 they offered the last time out. So,
well, the new figure that you just quoted, the $1.3 billion, is what is now on the table as a compromise position, and it will fund not the entire wall that Trump wants, but a portion of some kind of a barrier that they expect to erect. Frankly, I don't care about that.
Well,
I really don't.
I'm getting to your point about the insanity of the president. Right?
They don't know. They've been caught really with their pants down. They have no idea how best to craft this, because you see, so many things are happening at the same time. They have to work out a formal relationship, which they did not have with this president. Donald Trump does not believe in consulting anybody. He doesn't consult his generals. He doesn't consult his advisors, except for his son-in-law, Jared Kushner, and his daughter, the senior advisor, Ivanka Trump, and his other son, Eric Trump. He does not consult with anybody. And whoever he's consulting with would be unknown to the rest of us, even to his generals, even to his security team, even to his cabinet members. He's running this as a solo project. And immediately what we ought to be thinking about is it's crooked from the start. It's absolutely a crooked arrangement. Trying to, you know, he's dressing it up in legitimate clothing, but it's not. What we need to do is remain focused on what we as citizens have to do and residents of this country, what we have to do. Our focus should be, as I say all the time, our survival. That is the number one objective we all ought to have. That craziness will continue, but we must see to our survival and demand their accountability for what they must do to assure the entire country's survival. It is unconscionable to me that a president can stick up, can hold up, and do a robbery in broad daylight for everybody to see of 800,000 people, and we're all still, quote, normal as a country. I just don't understand that.
May I help you?
Sure.
Okay. In this particular instance, the bad guy is actually Mitch McConnell.
No, he's not.
Excuse me?
I don't believe that. I don't agree. Mitch McConnell is not the bad guy. There are a whole bunch of bad guys here. And that's what we need to understand. The one bad guy, the absolute bad guy, is the President of the United States.
Would you
Congress Congress's job is to keep him in check and to protect the interests of the people.
You're right, and they're not doing it.
Right. And then, so, because they're not doing it, what should our reaction be? That's my question. What should our reaction be? What, therefore, is incumbent upon us to compel them to understand? I mean, even if they think they're running a dictatorship, we know that this is not, and it should not be. That's a question.
The reason that the Senate has backed Donald Trump so far is because they think it is the way to maintain their employment. Pat Toomey is on with Christian Amanpour spinning some nonsense. What I'm suggesting is that if all Americans who have a heart and want those people to get funded demand that 67 senators and 290 members of the House vote for a clean bill and get these people paid.
All right, but that's not the whole picture. This now is a multidimensional issue. We have a renegade president. That's what we need to come to terms with, and Congress is permitting it. We have a chaotic renegade president who is running this country as a dictatorship. And if 800,000 people don't merit the seriousness of attention that this requires, what does it say about this Congress? Why do we have elections? Why do we trust Congress? They let this president conduct a stick up and get away with it. And we now have to ask, what exactly is this thing we call, you know, the United States, this process? Is this democracy? What is it? We just witnessed a holdup, a national holdup. And we're acting as if, well, it's, you know, the procedures will go in place and solve it. The procedures are not the issue. They're there. The procedures are already there. What do you do when the president decides he does not need to follow procedures and he could make life a living hell for 800,000 people as he gets up in the morning? And within a matter of hours, the entire country becomes something else. This is the cause of alarm. Thanks a lot, Daryl, for your call. I appreciate it. Gwen from New York, you're on the air.
Hi, Utrice. I hope you're having a nicer day down there than we are up here. I'm sure you are. I'm very sure you are. It's horrible here.
Well, not really.
I really just called in to give you the weather report, okay? So that's all I have to say. All right. So I'll take your whatever's going on in South Florida next to this crap. I don't agree with the last caller about Mitch McConnell. I kind of don't understand why he thinks it could only be Mitch McConnell. Mitch McConnell is a total piece of crap. But to say also that it's just the president, the problem with it just being the president is that he's got everyone with him too. And they're with him out of fear. They're afraid to say no to him. They're afraid to buck him. And so we are all getting screwed because we have,
requires a change in us.
Right, exactly. Like, why don't the 800,000 people just not go to work? I mean, why do you keep showing up for a job you're not getting paid for? Why don't you go out and protest? And why? I mean, you know, when the president was screwing with the immigration laws and everybody started to show up at the airports to support the people that weren't being allowed to leave or come in, you know, all kinds of people just on their own went to the airport to support people. And I'm pretty sure if the people that are being furloughed, or their pay is going to be withheld because of the government's shutdown, I'm pretty sure that there is a lot of Americans that would get with them in the streets. And I also think it would be a fantastic kickoff to just basically, you know, bucking this whole system. Like, let them be the lead, but get out there. Somebody get out there and start. Does it really have to be me? Do I have to go downtown again with a sign by myself? But I will tell you that, speaking of signs by yourself, you can be very productive. I remember when the banks were going, you know, like all the stuff was going on in 2008 with the banks, and I was supposed to go to a protest, but I got there too late. But I had this fantastic sign, and I said to my friend, you know, I'm just going to stand here on Wall Street with my sign for an hour, just because I want to protest, I want to do something. You know how many people stopped? And this was interesting to me. I didn't say one thing. Interestingly enough, for me, I stood there for 6 hours and didn't say anything. But hundreds of people gathered around to look at this sign and then kept moving and had questions. And it was a real showstopper. And I was really, really surprised that if just that small action can bring a lot, at least in the way of thoughtfulness. So, you know, I don't have a solution for the president, you know, and I'm, as I said, really scared that this is not isolated, that this is not just happening in the United States. It's happening all over the world, where people are choosing to have dictators, or dictators are just being installed. I would say, you know, as far as the United States leadership, the fish is rotten from the head down. And I know that from just even my most recent interaction running for the public advocate's office, where literally I was told I was not allowed to speak in front of any Democratic audience at these we were having forums. And literally, the only thing I was allowed to say at one forum was my name, and then they pulled me down. They said, you must sit down. You must not say anything. And it was the strangest thing because, you know, I was properly registered. I have a bank account. Everything was, you know, in running form. But somebody knew that I was going to say something, maybe that they didn't like. And it's amazing. I guess I was taken by the breathtaking way that it was all manipulated behind the scenes. I really walked into that one. So I really do think that you are chosen to govern. I don't think in this country really, I don't know how many people really get elected. Even Alexandria Cortez, I'm not really sure if she was allowed to walk through the door because she was going to be the catapult here, or whether she really won that election. I think the elections are very, very rigged in the United States, and I think there's a lot that goes on behind the scenes. And I think there's an ocean of people that are frustrated. Go ahead.
But do you see that in the end, when all is said and done, I mean, you have a good analysis and a good idea of the landscape that we're dealing with. But when it comes to our survival, one of the things that we must understand is, what is the system? And to what degree are we responsible for what we are experiencing as the system? In this situation where we have President Chaos doing whatever he wants to do on any given day at any given time with apparent liberty or permission, whether explicit or tacit, but he has it, it seems, because he's exercising his own vision, his own way of doing things, and he is not being checked. And even when we have the garish example, which is an extreme example of a president sticking up the country, sticking up 800,000 workers And the country is quiet about it.
Right.
It will all work out. All we have to do is wait and see what other good things come out of the head of Zeus. This is part of the process of extreme brilliance and creativity. Sometimes you have to do extreme things. Is that what we're experiencing?
I think that what we're experiencing is the dumbing down of America, that America also is terrified because of all of the things that are behind the scenes in terms of the way the police can kill with impunity, the fact that your face is all over the place, your computers are being looked at, you can be looked at, you know, from your TV. So there is Big Brother all over the place. And if you want to go out, and you want to protest against this government, you need to take all that into consideration, because a protest isn't just a protest anymore. I mean, you know, it was pretty bad in the 60s. A lot of people were getting killed. There was a lot of COINTEL stuff going on, but it's like that now on steroids. And on top of it, America has really been dumbed down. I mean, look at America. We're way fat. We're way out of shape. We're mentally out of shape. We're physically out of shape. And all we want to do is get pleasure and keep pleasure and shut out the rest if we can. And at the same time, you're being dump trucked, filled with negative information all the time. It's very heavy and it's very hard to stick your head out of that cement and say, let me take on this one cause. Let me get back out there again. You need to just brush all that aside if you're going to go back out and you're going to fight these battles. But as I said before, I think that it's almost would be a blessing. I hate to say it. I don't want anybody to lose their pay, but wouldn't it be fantastic if those 800,000 workers hit the streets and then we all got with them? That's a big enough uprising for this government to pay attention to.
Truth of that. Somebody better speak up and tell us what is the truth. Are these workers being intimidated? Are these workers being told, even by their own unions, to lay low?
No, the beauty of it is, they're not. The beauty of it for the government is, no, they're not. This is a typical American, you trees. Who do you know really gets up and goes out and does?
This is not the typical government. These are, because there are elements that we need to appreciate that are slightly different. These are federal workers.
Yes, they are. They are.
Okay.
And their unions didn't take them out. And, you know, I hope there's some listening, because they could do us all a favor by going out. I would be happy to lock arms with a federal worker to fight for their right to get paid. And I'd be happy to start the movement that way.
The workers may be under even additional pressure to do nothing, to just lay low.
But you're still not getting paid.
I know.
What's the difference?
But this is the thing. So it's more than the president out of order. It mm-hmm. is also the union behaving in a manner that is rather suspicious.
Are you surprised?
And the other union.
My God. My husband worked for the post office for 36 years. The post office is run by a union that at the hierarchy is all white men that basically sell out everybody else that works underneath of them, which the majority are black men and women. And so it's very, very seldom that the head of the union, you know, I asked to speak at their protests because I was the wife of a postal worker and wanted to explain to people what was really going on, how the post office is not really in a deficit. It was a deficit created by the Bush administration because they have to put away $75 million in pension funds. I'm sorry, but they have to put their $5 billion worth in pension funds 75 years ahead of the time before they retire. That's why they look like they're in debt, but they're not really in debt. And I remember, you know, the union clerk saying, no, we're not even going to talk about that. Well, that was the only game in town because that's the reason they always use to shut down the post office. And yet, if you go to a post office, you will never see a post office that's not busy, not one. They're always packed. There's always a line. It's always a pain in the neck. So guess what? The post office is doing business. Are they in a deficit? Yes, but it was created by this government. And it was created to screw them up, to trip their feet. And when I look at a lot of unions and I look at the people at the top, I don't know. It looks like they're not really working for the guys at the bottom. And that's a problem, too. I mean, the unions need to be cleaned out, too. if they're not representing you, then they need to be voted out too.
All right. Well, thank you very much for your spirited, and I love this about you, your spirited opinions and attitude and your clarity. Thank you so much for calling in today. Ma'at from New York, you're on the air.
Yes, great to get in. Greetings to the beloved community. I have an analysis of this in terms of the shutdown that has the both it looking worse and also better. So I saw a clip with, I believe it's Senator Van Hollen. He was with a sister, a security guard. In addition to the 800,000 people who had to work and weren't paid for 5 weeks, there were also 1.3 million people who were furloughed. And as contractors, the cooks, the security people, the cleaners, and the janitors, Van Hollen was saying that he's about to put in a bill that would provide their being paid. So until that bill goes through, 1.3 million were furloughed, weren't paid. If you remember, the White House had to call this brother who, the second time around, he didn't pick up the phone as he was being interviewed, but they were needing somebody to shovel the snow. And if you recall that event he had with a college team, he had to go to Wendy's and what have you because the cooks weren't. Those are the contract workers. But let's look at some of this history, though, because back before the holidays, December 18th and 19th, the Dems and the Republicans had come up with a funding bill for a little over a month, and it had all been agreed on. And the Senate actually, with all those Republicans before the new year, passed it unanimously without a dissent. And then Trump heard Ann Coulter and Rush Limbaugh, and he decided he would fight for his wall. So he's the number one culprit. But let's put the deficit where it belongs, because Mitch McConnell and the Republicans, not the Congress, Nancy and her troops, they kept passing bill after bill. They even separated the bills for the funding. And at one point, the Department of Homeland Security was put aside because that was a, and they passed it and passed it. And McConnell literally disappeared into that private room that he could go in, and he didn't dealt with it. So basically, we have one party now, because I don't hear anybody talking about what's going to replace the Republicans that have been completely complicit in someone who's an obviously unfit person, which you seem to be suggesting. And I suggest in the March this year's issue, Yanni Applebaum, and it's online too, it's called Impeach. It's time for Congress to judge the president's fitness to serve. And I sort of had a different view of what I saw with some of the unions, because on the cable TV, the unions were doing certain actions, and they were, you know, speaking out. They had to deal with it in a certain way because they literally cannot go off the job, else they're subject to lose their job. Okay, and usually the shutdowns aren't too long, except this was the first one that a president did, as opposed to a Congress, to shut down his own government. And my last point is that the media has me pulling out my hair, in that they
No. Don't go any further. You don't have to tell us why the media has you pulling out your hair, because we already know. The question still is, are we taking the situation seriously enough? Do we see it as a direct assault on people's survival? And it will, of course, grow to other arenas as well, other types of workers, other areas of work.
Of autocracy. Oh. Well, that was the point that I was about to make, is why too many of the media, NPR, MSNBC, CNN, why they keep talking about a possible, they're wringing their hands about a possible shutdown, when the idea of the president acting in that way should be something that would just be beyond the pale. So exactly the point that I was,
I'm psychic. So indeed. I read your mind. Thanks for your call today.
Thank you.
That's the question. That's the only question that we need to be concerned about. People's survival and being deliberately railroaded by none other than the president of the country and his minions, and getting away with it. And the people who we look to, the people who allegedly are elected to safeguard the interests of all of us, are having all kinds of reasons for not engaging in a direct assault against it, because they're getting paid. They're getting paid. People are not getting their checks, but they're getting paid. There's a whole lot of wrong here. And we need to be very vocal about it, very active about it, and to call people out. And not only that, to make it a matter so serious that we are not going to fall for the idea of, well, there are so many parts to this moving engine. No, we want this engine dead. This engine has got to come to a halt. It's no good. We want this engine thrown out. It is of no use, certainly not to the people. Willie from Brooklyn, you're on the air.
Good afternoon, beloved.
Hello.
How are you doing? Good afternoon. How are you doing?
Okay, I'm hanging in.
First, let me say, on your shoulders, I stand. On Gary's shoulders, I stand. And Mr. Farkin's shoulder, I stand. But I just want to say this. Let's be very clear. I'm not saying you're a liar, but you know how to dress up a lie. I like to be plain. We're talking about the Congress. That's not a Congress. That's the Knesset. Let's be very clear on that. Brother Khalid Muhammad made a speech in front of a private audience of about 300 people. The next day, the Congress had enough time to censor a private citizen. So who really are these people working for? You see what I'm saying?
You're a little off center here. We're talking about this particular issue of the president being permitted by a Congress that looks like they're just posing as legislators, but they're not doing what they're supposed to do. And the central question here is the conduct of the president and whether he, by his actions, imperils the survival of all Americans.
Well, your chief, you did a very program on the so-called president. I'm very, very clear on who he is. That's not a president. So you did a program on his mindset, on his physical state of his mind, the state of his mind. And we know he's insane. So to look to him for anything other than insanity, we are the ones that have the problem, not him.
Well, that's my point. My point is, we should reorganize our priorities. Our priorities have to do with putting our collective survival at number one. And anybody imperiling that is somebody who we should really, we should take out of office. We should challenge that person.
Yes, I agree.
Our survival, our collective survival is number one.
Well, you know, that plan in my is being put in place already. The major part of the work is done, and you are part of it, because we must first educate the masses of what we are doing, what we choose to do. Because when you tune into that station, this station, you know, you don't have to second guess the information. It's truthful information. So once we build it and you guys tell us what it is, because, you know, start with me. We ain't got no sense, much sense. Start with me. Once you tell us, the great minds within that organization comes up with a plan, and which some of them already have, we will follow it. It's simple.
But, Willie, here's the technical difficulty that arises. Our job is not to make a plan. Our job is to educate the people so that they can make a plan. Our job is to point out that there are people who ought to be about nothing other than making a plan who are not making a plan, or who are making plans that appear to be more in concert with the situation that we're confronting as opposed to our survival. That's what we are supposed to be doing. But I can't make a plan and say, well, this is what you ought to do. And we're looking at a situation. You can't get something, anything clearer in terms of what a person's potential choices are. And that is, you can't accept this. You cannot accept this, and certainly not accept it as democracy. So we now have some accounting to do. What really are we putting up with here? What are we endorsing by our inaction and by our still voices? What are we endorsing?
Madness. Madness.
Trump's or ours?
You see, you trees. You did you pointed us that Gary, and there's so many people within PRN. They've been teaching us. You know, there was a caller that came on before the last poll caller. It's not a coincidence. This has been the dumbing down of America. Minister Farrakhan did a program on that, a lecture on that 30 years ago. So this is not a coincidental. These people, the American people, are totally out of their mind. So now it is, we have the tool. PR is right here. I know you must be tired of me talking about PR. But I talk about PRN to everybody, because what? You can teach the masses of people instead of CNN and Cartoon Network News, you know, that kind of stuff. I don't even have a TV. Because I feel very insulted to be deceived and lied to every day. And there's so many people that do.
We're off the topic a bit. So get back to topic. What is, therefore, the challenge before us?
We have, in order for us to do any, for us to work on a problem, we have to know what the problem is. Most people do not know. They're not clear. PRN brings clarity to all of the majority.
I accept that. But what, therefore, for those who have clarity, and even those who don't have clarity, what would you say is the challenge before us now, in this moment?
Well, we are getting rid of the gangsters in Washington. We gotta get rid of them, all of them, because they do not serve us. It's as simple as that. We vote for these people. It doesn't make sense to me. Because the Republicans are fighting for us. The Democrats are fighting for us. Well, okay, good. Who are you fighting? I don't understand. And we cannot see and understand that. Once we make our X, like you said, get lost. And we'll see another 4 or 2 years. That's the way it's been going on forever. The only reason why these things happen is because we've been misled by the so-called media.
Well, we'll have to leave it there because we're out of time. But thank you all. This is just such great peer-to-peer education. And you can't get better than this, really. When people, regular people, are sharing with you the hearts and minds around issues that affect us all, this is very, very valuable. And so I thank you always for making the effort to contribute something that adds to our understanding of things. I really, really respect you for that. And I thank you for that and holding to that standard. We'll get my Ed fixed up here so we get back to our regular program tomorrow. But I thank you so much. This more than made up for the program that we didn't get to do today. All right. Bye-bye.